Hello everyone, my name is Kelvin Ombati. I'm a student at the Software Global MBA program, and together with me today is Eyal Benjamin. There are so many great things I can say about Eyal Benjamin, being that I've also been in his, I've sat in his class, and basically I've been a recipient of some of the vast experiences that he has basically built up over life. And I don't know, an introduction, reading your bio, like, will be like an understanding. First of all, it's long, and I think you will have to maybe share with us more about that. But one thing I would like to tell the audience is Eyal has been a six-time serial entrepreneur. Yeah. When you say that people are serial entrepreneurs, what exactly do you mean by serial entrepreneurs?
Serial entrepreneurs are people who enjoy launching new ventures, and they continue building one venture after the other. So once they have their startup has matured and been handed over to either go to an IPO or sold to another company, they just go and launch another venture. So that's more or less what
serial
entrepreneurs are up to.
Okay, and that's just like half of it. So let's continue. Eyal has currently, you are a lecturer at Tel Aviv University.
Yes.
And Eyal is a faculty member, at the Coller School of Management. How is the experience there, getting to meet? First of all, you meet local people, and then there are the international team that you also get to teach. How do you feel about that?
Well, I must say that, first of all, working with younger people is a fantastic experience. It teaches you a lot as a professor. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to thank you as a student, as a faculty student, and thank you for bringing me here on this event, because it gives you an experience to look at things in a different way. So that's one thing. The second thing, obviously, different type of students come with different perspectives. If you look at the university as a place in which some kind of a raw material, which is people with their previous mindsets, get into this process or journey, and they leave after certain years with a different mindset and a different view of life and different understandings, capabilities, and skills. So there's kind of a raw material that goes through a facilitation or an improvement process, and by the time they're out in the market, they're better than what they were before.
How they came.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And there's a huge difference between the different type of the different types of people who enter the faculty. So it really depends if you are undergraduate and you're at the age of 18 or something, who came right out of high school, or you're undergraduate who came after a few years during your military service, and if you are in the IDF in Israel, or did your IDF plus a few years of traveling the world, or if you came here as an MBA. If you came into your MBA studies after working a few years as a professional in some place in the world. And obviously there is a different culture that each and every student comes with. So you came from Kenya, you have the culture that you have, and other students came from other countries. So they come with a different background, knowledge, values that they get into the process. And you as a professor or as a facilitator, you have to improve each and every one of your students when they on their way out of the campus.
And as I said, those are just like the few of the titles that you have. Is there anything that maybe you would like to highlight out of the many hats that you get to wear every day? Which one is it that you like the most?
Out of the challenges that you have to go through?
Not the challenges, but that the many hats that you like. You are six times a serial entrepreneur. You are a lecturer. You are a father as well. I know that because you shared with us your background in class. So which of those titles do you feel you get to wear most, and which of them gets to drive you?
It's like asking, asking which of your children you love the most, or
Don't you always have favorites?
No. No, I love my kids differently but equally. I mean, differently but equally. Look, all those activities that one does in life, working with you guys on your studies and trying to, is one process. Working with myself, because if I have to teach you guys something, and not just you as MBA students or any other students, when I work with executives or when I facilitate our founders in the Dan Launchpad or in the Coller Startup Competition, just for being able to facilitate other people, I have to do some unlearning myself and trying to bring myself to my student's point of view. And doesn't really matter if the student is an undergraduate, an MBA student, an executive in a company, or a founder in a venture.
And I must say, you are doing an amazing job at it, because
thank you.
My perspective about entrepreneurship and basically like the ecosystem and how to get into it and how to create value into it changed when I sat in your class. And maybe just to follow up on that is, you have been in this ecosystem for like quite a considerable amount of time. What is it that you think really influenced your drive to want to get involved into the entrepreneurial space at a young age that really shaped that journey for you?
I think that the honest answer of what got me into being an entrepreneur myself and to being in the entrepreneurship world is that I don't like authority. I learned that not at home, but when I left home, I learned that I don't like other people telling me what to do. Okay, so I must say that my brother learned that in a much younger age than me, but...
Oh, so your brother was like...
So he was a rebel from age three, but I was not a rebel, but I felt discomfort when I was in my 20s. I felt a lot of discomfort when other people told me what to do. And I said, okay, so I have to run my own business because I don't like having bosses.
How was that the first time you tried it out?
The first time we tried it out was very easy it wasn't very easy on a total, but it was very, let's say, natural, because I was working in a student job, just as like anyone has to pay his bills while doing his classes. Yeah. I worked in a kind of a medium-sized company, and they were doing this stuff and I was working for them as an employee. But then I noticed that there are things that could have been done in that company and they're not being done. So I said, okay. So I came to my boss at the time and I said, well, there are a few things that can be done better here. So you have X amount of products, you can have Y amount of products, which is that you don't do today. And she said, okay, do you think you can do it? I said, yes, I can. And she said, you do it. So I came to my friend and I said, look, we have an opportunity here to build our own products and sell them to their company. And that's what you've done. And after a very short time, I think it was maybe a year, maybe two, or a year and a half. So we actually managed the entire company and we bought them out and it was our company. But it took a few years for that to happen. It took a few years for us to get mature, and our products were pretty good and successful. So we had the luck of having one of the best mentors in Israel at the time. So we did not launch the venture out of total scratch.
Mm-hmm. So would you say that currently that is like what someone passed on to you is the same thing you're trying to pass on to others, but in a larger scale in terms of mentorship?
In a larger scale, but in a different scale. Because what we did at the time was a certain flavor of entrepreneurship. At the time, I did not know what entrepreneurship is. I was not even familiar with the word. We're just trying to create a new business.
Okay,
and based on an existing business, but a flavor of that, which was quite of innovative at the time to that specific ecosystem, but it was in the world of education, or let's say expanding after school education, if you like. So we were in a specific environment and we expanded it and enlarged it, but it was not a real startup as you would define it today as a startup. Looking backwards, we were very lucky to have this opportunity to launch a venture aside of an existing company with some mentorship, and it was quite good.
I think speaking of ventures and like how you launched a venture, and one of the things that I remember we learned in your class was, and you really like put in a lot of emphasis on it, is about the culture. And Israel is known as the startup nation. And one of the things that I know from my classmates and me as well, one of the things that we usually like look forward to is to seeing the difference in that culture of where we are from and the culture in Israel. How would you say you have handled students from like international teams, local teams, people who have also like gone through the army? What would you say there, like the difference in culture and how the culture in Israel itself is able to like shape up that entrepreneurial mindset amongst your students?
First, I don't know if you feel it, because it should be easier for you coming from abroad to grasp the gap between the culture you grew up in and the Israeli culture. Okay, I grew up here.
Well, I will say it's different for me, because I will look at myself as easy to inspire, because I landed at Ben Gurion Airport and I saw on the wall it was written "Dare to Dream," and I knew that okay, that's my light bulb moment, and that has always been like something that is continuously driving me.
So for you personally, the Israeli culture was in line with your personal aspirations.
Yeah,
but if you look at the culture in Kenya and compare that everyday activity, mm-hmm. culture, risk awareness, propensity to change, etc. And you compare it to what you've seen here in the last almost a year that you've been here in Israel. Are they similar? Can you feel the gaps? Do you see differences between the behavior of Israeli students or startups that you were in contact with or founders to the people you know in Kenya?
Maybe I will answer one of that, and then maybe you'll also share like the experience that you've had with other students or like people, like international students who have actually launched mm-hmm. businesses in Israel. I think for me, there are differences in terms of when we do entrepreneurship, or like what I've seen people do here is like people move fast, and in the sense that something may not be yet perfect, but as long as it can create that impact and give value to people and it's going to actually change lives, it will be launched.
Okay.
And there is just that confidence of every entrepreneur feels like they have something that is worth being put there in the market for people to be able to see.
I think you're right. I think that pace is something that you can see. You can see that people here are moving faster, but moving faster is a result of... Uh-huh. You can move faster when you are confident in what you do.
Mm-hmm.
You can move faster when you have the skills. You can move faster when you have the resources. And the resources is quite a diverse word. So you have to have funding, you have to have networking, you have to have capabilities, you have to have a lot of things in order to knowledge, in order to be able to move fast.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you can't move fast if you don't have all of those in your hands, okay, at your disposal. And the question is, how is it that let's say the common Israeli has more of those capabilities and skills and resources and the desire to move faster than the others?
Yeah.
Okay. So back to your specific questions. Yes, I believe that I can feel the difference in culture between Israelis and let's say other nations, not all nations, but other nations. I think that all of those differences eventually translate into a much larger propensity to start startups and big startups and global startups. And you have a lot of evidence for that. It's not just my opinion. You can look at the evidence and you can see how many startups per capita are established in Israel compared with other places, how many unicorns per capita grew out of Israel versus other places in the world. And the numbers are very, very impressive. Okay, they're very strong.
Would you like to maybe tell us... Well,
I it's not a research that I have done, but let me see if I can say the name. Ilya, I'm not sure. I don't want to mispronounce his name. Stanislav, I think his name is. From Stanford, he's done a lot of research on that topic, and he actually examined the unicorns about. I don't have the exact numbers here, but he examined the huge amount of unicorns, and he noticed that 44% of them were non-US born. Okay, and if you look at those who are non-US born startups, there were about 575 founders coming from the US, and the rest from abroad. And if you look at the founders who came from other countries, you see that India is the first with 90 founders, and Israel is second with 52 founders, Canada third with 42 founders, etc.
I actually remember those statistics because we did it in class. And the other thing you mentioned, that if Israel was the size of, like, let's say US and India, exactly, we would probably have more founders.
And if you account, if you just do the math and say, okay, Israel has about 9.6 million people and the US has about 330 million people. Mm-hmm. And you took the same ratio, Israel would have had 1,750 unicorn founders. Okay, so by far, it's a much bigger number any way you look at it. India is 90 founders, Israel is 52, but India is not two times bigger than Israel. It's like 100 times bigger, maybe 1,000 times bigger than Israel. Okay, so it's much bigger.
Yeah.
It's way much bigger than Israel. So there is something here which is different in the way that people do stuff that creates this unique outcome of the number of startups, the quality of the startups, the impact of the startups, which is not so common in other places in the world. And I don't think that there is one single reason why Israel has become a startup generator, which is so strong compared with other places in the world. I think that there are several reasons. One of them is character, which is built at the younger age. Mm-hmm. And it's built in younger age, not towards entrepreneurship. It's built in other programs.
Survival.
But it serves the entrepreneurship mindset. So, for example, the Boy Scouts in Israel is much different than the Boy Scouts in every other place in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's much more robust. You get much more responsibility at a much younger age. You're not pampered so much. And you have a lot of friction with the reality. But you grow up with much bigger capabilities. You grow up with a much, much bigger managerial experience, which is relevant to children at high school, but it is management. You manage projects, you manage people, you manage teams, you do stuff which usually is not done by other children in the world at the same programs. And then you go into to your IDF service for a few years, you get even more responsibility, and then you travel the world and you get different mindsets and you get different views. So by the time you're 23 or 24, your personal character has changed immensely since you were 13 or 14. And this is not towards building a startup, but if you decide to build a startup, it gives you a lot of advantage.
And how would you say that you try to, like, take some of those skills, compress them and incorporate them into the programs that us who are not from Israel come to do, and actually come out with the same skill set?
Okay, so this is a question that you should answer, but
no, but you've interacted with. I can answer it on a personal note, but I think also when you look at your students, you see them with different capabilities, and they all also, like, take different routes in life. Some are more risk averse, some are more risk takers, yeah. And I think that's
so. There are a few things that you as a facilitator have, or I as a facilitator have to do with international students who come here. But we can do I can do things in class. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I could expect you to do things which you're not used to do. I expect you to ask questions. And because in some cultures, it's not that global MBA students come from different cultures.
Yeah.
Okay, so some cultures are not so talkative and not so questionative in class. I can just try doing one simple experiment. Sit in a class which is 100% Israelis. Okay? Just for an hour, and you'll notice the difference.
Well, I've been here long enough. I know the answer.
Okay? They will never let the teacher speak for a second. They will challenge every word he says.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Which is different than the MBA class, the international classes. Okay? In which, in some classes, not yours, yours was a fantastic class, but in other classes, I had to beg for questions because it's not in the culture
to ask
students to ask questions. Okay? And to my personal view, it harms the class. Okay, the entire discussion, the entire dynamics of class is extremely harmed when there are no live Q&A in class. Okay, so I had to encourage students to ask questions. I have to give them some kind of tasks that they don't like to do mm-hmm. in many cases. So to work with other people that you're not used to work with, to take people out of the comfort zone. But again, it's not that within like a 14-week semester you're able to condense like 10 years of practice. Okay, so you can do what you can do. But this is the formal side. The non-formal side, which I know that you personally have experience, is to get some friction with the ecosystem, which is extremely important. Mm-hmm. So you want to do a lot of stuff outside of class. So you want to go to events and you want to listen to people who are not your professional lecturers. You want to have some inspiration talks live inspiration talks with veterans of the industry, of the Israeli ecosystem, startup ecosystem. You want to meet other co-founders in events. You want to work in a startup, one startup, maybe even two, maybe even three as an intern. Mm-hmm. Get the dynamics, see how people work, see how they make decisions. Try to see the type of challenges they have to go through. Try to see how they confront those challenges and how they solve those problems, which in many cases will be different than what you would see in other cultures. Okay, again, not because this is the Israeli culture is superior, because it's better. It better serves the challenges of startups, which are different than classic managerial challenges. Okay, you have to work fast. You have to work semi-accurate. You have to maneuver yourself under extreme uncertainty, etc. So these type of decisions and management skills are specific to the startup world.
And I have one final question that I prepared, and then there is a couple of lists of questions that my classmates also wanted to hear you answer. And I think what I wanted to ask you is, like, for you personally, how do you balance doing all these things and also having your chill time to just relax and have fun? Like, what would you consider as Eyal having fun? What would be that moment
so for you? This is a challenging question, because I have a lot of fun teaching. I enjoy my students. I enjoy spending time.
That is not related to...
Yeah, and I enjoy working with the founders and working with startups. I really enjoy that. I mean, so it's not that I suffer at work or I go to and I come exhausted. Teaching is not an easy task, especially if you want to give the right attention to your students. But it's not something I do not enjoy. The time I have to myself, this is the time which I balance myself, is when I go sports. So my sports are cycling and mostly off-road biking. Mm-hmm. And when you go into the single tracks, into the woods, into the mountains, you have to be extremely focused on your cycling. Otherwise, you'll end up in a tree. So and
I did end up in a tree.
Really? Oh my god.
Yeah, but it's okay.
So but having to be concentrated in cycling or in climbing just blocks your brain for a few hours on thinking of anything else, and it resets the brain and your entire body goes into kind of a restart mode. And if you do it like 3 times a week, it's good enough.
Okay, so I will read out some of the questions that my classmates wanted me to ask you. And the first one is, despite the successes that every ecosystem faces its challenges, what are some of the biggest obstacles facing Israeli startups today?
Wow. Well, you're asking this question at right kind of in a war situation. So first of all, Israel is an economic island. Okay, so we have very little business borders with our neighbors. Mm-hmm. Okay, and that places a huge challenge over Israeli startups, which they have managed to learn how to be born in global ventures at day one. That being said, And it worked fantastically. All of those unicorns we mentioned earlier, all those 50 unicorns are all multinational ventures established as ones. That being said, even though we have learned as an ecosystem how to build global ventures, the startup ecosystem is highly influenced by the shape and the positioning of Israel in the global media.
Mm-hmm.
So if Israel's brand is harmed, it will most likely damage to a certain extent the capabilities of Israeli startups. Okay? We don't know exactly to what extent and how much. We know that there is an impact. I don't think that we can quantify it now because we are still in the turmoil of events.
Mm-hmm.
But I believe that there's going to be an impact.
Thank you. And another person asked, can you share specific success story or challenges you faced in your success stories and challenges that you faced in your entrepreneurial journey that exemplifies the startup spirit of Israel?
I don't know if I can share specific stories that are specific to Israel. Israel, maybe one, but I'll start with the challenges, which is the most important thing. When you want to be a father
mm-hmm.
and a founder at the same time, it's a huge challenge. It's a huge challenge.
How do you balance that?
I don't think you can.
How did you manage it?
You try to manage that, but when you have to get on the flight and travel for 12 hours to meet your customers or your investors, you just go on a flight and you go and meet them. And when you do that week away, your child is in the kindergarten or in school and they have their events and they have their activities and they grow and you're not with them. So this is a price. This is absolutely a price. And I think that there is a limit to the extent of how can you, there's a limit to the level that you can mitigate this mm-hmm. challenge, okay, or this, to balance this, okay? That being said, there are several founders. Some of them are winners of the Coller Startup Competition and founders that we have today at the Dan Launchpad, which is another startup facilitation program here at Tel Aviv University,
mm-hmm.
Which were pregnant during creating their venture and actually almost they got their first investment in the maternity room. Okay, so these things happen and people can do. In Hebrew, you call it lemakbel. I don't know if I can translate it into English. It's called, I'll try to translate it to parallelize thing, meaning to do two things in parallel simultaneously. So to be a mother and a startup founder simultaneously. So I think you could do that and it works to a certain extent. I was not as good as being a founder and a father as good as I could have. At least at two of my ventures.
I think we will revisit that in our final question. The other question I will see, you are at Dan Launchpad.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I've also interacted with some of the startups that you are working with. And I must say that most of them, they are geared towards impact, towards making life better. And just to ask you, what are some of the things that you look for in a startup before you actually allow them to come on board? This is for people who may be listening to this and they will they're looking for that incubation space for their startups or for the ideas that they have.
Okay. So two things. First, which is very most important thing, we usually do not decline a startup. We either accept a startup or give them homework of how to improve in order to be accepted.
Amazing.
Okay? Because we believe that every venture has the opportunity to improve themselves as long as they get proper feedback
mm-hmm.
and they do their homework properly and they come back with us. Once their homework is done, you say, okay, well, that's fine. Let's start working together. Okay? But it's up to the ventures to decide or the founders to decide if they want to improve themselves in order to be accepted to the program. Okay, so we do not decline them. They decline themselves if they decide to not to improve their venture. or so that's one thing. As to the criteria that you asked, there are a few things that you would expect to see in a venture. You would expect to see the round team. A round team means that they have the adequate, the relevant capabilities, that they have the specific capabilities which are required. You want to see a team that knows how to work together with the right experience or the enough experience. I wouldn't say that they have to be like the best ever, but they have to be good enough to be able to improve as we move forward, because nobody comes with a perfect high score in everything. Okay.
Yeah.
And remember, we are a facilitation program. We're not a selection program.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that we select good from bad. We try to facilitate and make as many good ventures come out to the market from the Tel Aviv University
as possible.
So that's one aspect. The second aspect, we look at the innovation or the level of innovation. We support or we facilitate only innovative ventures. We do not facilitate classic businesses. We look at the maturity of the technology or the product or the service that the teams are trying to build.
Mm-hmm.
We want to see that it is beyond just an idea.
And when you say classic business, for someone who may like that may be a foreign term for them, like what would you classify as a classic business?
So I'll explain that. It's a very good question. So we at the edges, you will see two type of ventures.
Mm-hmm.
Ventures which are imitative ventures, which are the classic businesses. So you open another pizza shop or another laundry place or another car.
Pizza shops would be classic business.
Exactly.
Okay.
Because they're imitating existing businesses already in the market.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe you have your flavor because your pizza has ananas and the other ones don't have ananas or whatever, pineapples or anything. Okay, but at the other end, we have innovative businesses. Innovative businesses usually come and create something that was not there before, based on technology, based on behavior, based on many other things attributes. So they're first of their kind, or almost first of their kind. We support the latter more than the former.
And while we are still on the ventures and technology, because you mentioned technology, what are some of the trends that you see? Are actually scaling in Israel, and like you actually like say that this technology is going to actually disrupt the market, for example, we have, and how are the startups in Dan Launchpad embracing some of those technological trends?
So one keyword that comes in almost in any submission that we receive today goes to AI.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if it's going to be impactful or not. I don't know if this promise that AI brings to the universe today will be fulfilled. But I do see many ventures and many founders taking advantage of the new technologies, of the new standards, of the new acceptance of AI in everyday life, and trying to leverage that to create value. Again, I'm not a prophet, and I don't know. I'm not even a good forecaster. I don't know if they're going to be successful or not. But I can certainly see the trend of trying to embrace AI into almost any problem that we have around us.
Mm-hmm.
This is something that you can clearly see, that all kinds of machine learning and natural language processing and everything, all those go in many submissions that we see.
And for students who like to come and study in, let's say, in Israel, specifically to Tel Aviv University, what's that one advice that you like or message that you like to give them as a professor who has interacted with many students, or maybe even like a preparation, something to just like prepare them on what they will meet on the ground?
I will say that just do it. Just do it. It looks scary. It looks at the end of the world. It looks like there are many reasons why not to do your MBA in Tel Aviv. That's one thing. And the second thing that when you do it, it's not going to be the easiest path you're going to take. It's not going to be like a walk in the park. It's going to be challenging, but you'll come out of the process much better than you were when you got into the process.
Thank you. And thank you. I think that's it from mine. And I would like to like maybe request you, like we had some of my classmates here before, and one of the things we did, I gave them an opportunity to ask me a question, and I would like to do the same with you, to like if there is any question that you like to ask me from the perspective of a student to a lecturer, I probably know more about you than you know about me. And this will be a good opportunity for...
Yes, I would like to ask you a question. Uh-huh. Why did you decide, out of the so many opportunities you have in the world, so many MBA programs around the world, why you decide to come to this one?
First of all, I was already in Tel Aviv, and I had already interacted with the people, the culture, and to be honest, it is amazing. Like, I would say Israelis are the most awesome and welcoming people.
Thank you on behalf of the people in Israel.
And the other answer to that question is Shimon Peres.
Really?
Shimon Peres.
Wow. Okay, you have to explain that.
He has a book called No Space for Small Dreams. Mm-hmm. And every time I try to come up with an idea and make it happen, I still feel like there is a way that it is still small. Like, I read his story on how he got recruited in the army and the process that he took to mm-hmm. Basically build AAL, aircraft company.
Yeah,
and that was a motivation for me. And it actually, his story made me feel like I can do something different and extraordinary. So I'm still in this crossroad of just trying to find, I know what I want. I'm just trying to mix it up and see how the magic actually should come out.
But okay,
that is the reason why I chose to do my MBA here in Tel Aviv. First of all, the stats as well, 7th in Pitchbook. Uh-huh. I think you said you're not a prophet. I'm not a prophet, but I have the confidence that we are going to go higher in rank. And I think it's the most beautiful place to be in.
Thank you. I'll take that as a compliment to the university and the program and to the Israelis as well. It's not that.
Yeah, I say it's a beautiful place to be in, or to live actually as well. And thank you, Eyal, for agreeing to join us for the podcast.
Thank you very much, Kelvin, for inviting me and the opportunity to share.
I must just say that the moment this was launched, I presented it as an idea, and they asked me, who would you like to interview first? You are the first person that came to my mind, and I can see that. And I was really happy that you agreed to do it. And when I mentioned to my class that I was going to host you, all of them wanted to be here and participate, so maybe they should get a big studio where we can have the podcast for all of us. But thank you, Eyal. And where can people interact with you? People who to reach out to you?
Very easy to find. You can find me over. You can find me on LinkedIn. You can approach
guys,
me
just Google Eyal Benjamin.
You can find it very easily, LinkedIn or the website of the Dan Launchpad website or the Coller Competition website. Oh, it's very easy to find me.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.